So very good afternoon from the alumni of MS Ramya. It's a very nice thing to have this talk that we have been having, the alumni lecture series, and this is the second of the lecture series that we are having, and we propose to have at least six a year, and in due course we will bring out more and more talented and well-known alumni into the system and get them to advise, to talk to, and give their experiences. So, to start with, I would welcome all of you all to this webinar, hybrid webinar, because there are a few of us here already, and many of us are online too. And I would welcome the speakers, both Dr. Julius Munen. I think he's a person that we all know. He used to work here in Ramya, and more than that, he was a student here throughout his MBBS, and I had the good fortune of working with him even in KMC Manipal, and he was doing his cardiothoracic surgery, and I was doing my general surgery, after which he joined Narayana, and then he joined us. So he's the, actually many of us have looked up on to him. He's a person who did very well in showcasing Ramya. In fact, Manipal had made a rule that they are not taking Ramya students some time back. And Julius was the first, and I was the second person. Which now they are Ramya students. So there's a lot of things like this happening when we were students. So I would give the podium to our secretary, Dr. Vijay Das. He will introduce the speakers and formally, and then with not much delay, we will start with the talks.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you, sir, Ravi Gopal Varma, sir, for introducing, welcoming the for the program. So it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Nagmalesh, sir. Dr. Nagmalesh, UM, is a cardiologist, and has experience of 12 years in this field, and he practices in our college hospital, Ramya Memorial Hospital. And his key interest in coronary angioplasty, CRT, implantable cardioverter, defibrillators, and coronary angiogram, pacemaker, implantation, ECMO, VAD, heart transplant, etc. His unique skills are MCS, heart transplant, angioplasty, rotor ablation, SFR, and IVUS. And he's having a field of expertise in the advanced heart failure and transplant cardiology, interventional cardiology, heart failure and transplant, preventive cardiology, and rehab programs. And he has a lot of awards and recognition. Sir has a lot of professional membership certifications and many international and national publications. We are fortunate to have Nagmalesh sir here in our talk today. Sir is a part of our heart transplantation programs in our campus. Thank you very much for coming here.
So over. I'd like to put a word there. Actually, Dr. Nagmalesh and Dr. Julius together have put MS Ramya on the maps of heart transplant. I think for a medical college to have it, we are the first medical college. So that is where both of them have done a wonderful job for us and for the Karnataka people in general. And many places have now started transplant, and they have been helping many centers. And that is the most important thing. Ramya, with Dr. Nagmalesh and Dr. Julius, have gone to help many people, not looking at whether they are competition or not. It is the science that they have developed, and after which a lot of hospitals are, colleges are trying to do, hospitals are trying to do transplant and help patients. Over to you, Dr. Nagmalesh.
Thanks. Thank you for this kind word. I thank Ramya Alumni for giving this opportunity to address all of you. I think some people must have seen in the last 10 years I'm here, so many of you passed out for the last 10 years. So they told me to speak on heart transplant. So wondering what to speak, because a lot of specialties involved here, preclinical to clinical side. So then I thought I'll speak about how we select patient and who is eligible for transplant and what is the outcome. So probably that will make you interested because you also see day in day out this cardiac patient, end stage patient, end stage heart disease patients. So I think it will be helpful for you. So first we should know what is advanced heart failure. So we all know all heart failure patients are not eligible. All patients with ejection fraction of less than 30%, they are called severe LV dysfunction. They are not for transplant, so they can go on medical management for many years. So what is advanced heart failure? Is a condition is considered advanced when heart failure therapies and symptoms management strategies no longer work. So these are the patients who started them on all possible medications, devices, and you run guideline medical therapy. In spite of that, if they are not doing well, and these are the patient is called advanced heart failure, and these are the patient we select them or we plan to assess this patient for transplant. So if you look at heart failure classification, this is the classification. A is high risk for developing heart failure. So we should know what is heart failure. Even person without any structural heart disease, suppose the person who is diabetic or hypertensive, we call it as a stage A heart failure. So he is more prone for developing heart failure. So he should, you know, how important in treating this patient with diabetes and hypertension, because this is a place where you can prevent this patient progressing into heart failure. So heart transplant is not an option for the community. So it's only for a small fraction of patients. So better to prevent them in a very early stage. The B is those who have structural heart disease. So for example, person who is hypertensive, so you do echocardiography and say a mild concentric LVH. So it's just a mild concentric LVH. It's not just mild concentric LVH. Is already in stage B of heart failure, so it's more prone for developing heart failure in future. So these are the two category I feel is more relevant and more important for our country to prevent, because anything above this is not very good long-term prognosis and is very expensive also. So heart failure is very expensive disease. So next is C, it is symptomatic heart failure. These are the patients what you see regularly in hospital. Patient who come with heart failure, they take treatment, they go home, they get stabilized. These are the symptomatic heart failure. So D is one refractory heart failure, what we are talking today. This is a small fraction of patients who don't respond to regular therapies called refractory heart failure. So these are the patients who require a specialized intervention. So we call it as Intermax profile. So we have a lot of profile. I don't think I'll go in detail about that. The profile 1, 2, 3, 4. So it's some 7 profile. Based on that, we decide what device we have to use and how we have to manage this patient. Just one example. So a person who's in a critical cardiogenic shock, who's life-threatening hypotension despite rapidly escalating anatropic support. So this is very critical patient who required to intervention within hours. So you can't delay, you can't plan next day. You have to do today itself. So if you want to put ECMO, you want to put ventriculosis device, you have to initiate, otherwise they won't survive. So like this, there are 7. I don't think it is very important for you. So I will just go into a simple clinical clues. Probably many of you practicing this is very important for your day-to-day practice. Simple clinical clues to identify advanced heart failure. So because it makes a lot of difference between class C and class D heart failure. So their prognosis is quite bad. So you have to identify very early. So one is rehospitalization. So if you go to rehospitalization, the 20 to 25% the mortality at 30 days if they admitted with repeated admission, and 50% at 6 months. So if you treated your heart failure patient, is fine, I'll come back after 1 month or 2 months with the readmission. This mortality is already 20-25% at 30 days and 50% at 6 months. So it's not simple. You give some lasix, they feel better, but it doesn't mean that they are fine. So they have very high risk of mortality. So if you look at even an index admission, the person who's come with the first admission of heart failure, is got 25% mortality. So so number of hospitalization, it also determines the prognosis. If you see first admission, as you, I told you, 20-25% mortality, and if you look at fourth admission in a year, it carries 60% mortality. So these things we have to monitor and refer them to the right place if you are not managing this type of patients. So next is so unable to tolerate ACE inhibitor ARBs. So we treat all these patients with ACE inhibitor ARBs. If you are not able to start ACE inhibitor ARBs because you know, start ACE inhibitor, the BP goes down, or creatinine start going up. So these patients, you can look at them, those who are on, not on these drugs, their mortality is very high, especially those who are on inotropes, extremely high mortality. So high dose of diuretics, so must have seen patient taking 100 mg of furosemide two times, they feel better, they are fine, they are walking around, but they carry very high risk. And next is chronic inotropic therapy. So these are the so next is you know, those who are getting repeated ICD shocks, and those who are non-responder to biventricular pacing, and labile renal functions. So they keep coming to hospital with 2 creatinine, start them on inotrope, diuretics, they become all right. Then, you know, next day, next month, they come back with the same creatinine. So those who have labile renal function and unintended weight loss, these are the simple clinical clues to say patient is in advanced heart failure. So most of the time, even cardiologists, ourselves, we miss this stage, and they come when they are crashing. So in our country, if you try to do transplant in that stage, it's very expensive and risk also very high. So if you identify this stage, probably the cost is less and prognosis is good. Next is you know, what therapy we give for advanced heart failure. So we have diagnosed this patient with advanced heart failure. So what options they have for treatment? One is they can put them on chronic inotropic therapy if they are for a palliative care. Next is transplantation, ventriculosis device, and palliative care and end of life and including hospice. So we will just go to the parenteral inotropic therapy. So this, I have one patient now, he was registered already, he came crashing. So we put him on inotrope for almost 2 weeks now. And he's fine, he's got up, he said, I'm absolutely fine now. So this person running away from us every time when we treat and he's all right. When he's all right, he'll go away and he will not come back for the transplant. So this time we started him on inotrope, he stabilized. So these are the patients who do well on inotrope. Either you can start dobutamine or mildrenone. Mildrenone is better actually. Even you can start inotropic support and send him home if you want to do transplant a little later because of his nutritional state or because infection or his general condition is not good. So you can start them on this and stabilize them and do it. So, but you can look at this, if you don't transplant, their 12-year mortality is very, very high. So that's the reason these are the patients, even though they're palliative care or bridge to transplant, this patient should be transplanted as early as possible. So you can use this, the answer is just commonly, we can use this and send them home. It doesn't require any power. So next is ventriculosis device. So ventriculosis device, you can use it as a bridge to transplant, as a destination therapy. So these are the simple, as a temporary, we call it a central mat. So we have in our hospital, and in 2018, I think we have done highest number in the country and transplanted. Also the COVID last 2 years, we have not done because once we put this, we have to get heart and transplant, otherwise the mortality is very. So you can see here, so both it is supported by ventricular support. This is a console, can see from the right heart and the left heart. So both heart are supported with this machine. And those who are crashing, those who are arrested, and you know, they get up and say, you don't require your heart to pump, heart can be arrested, heart in VT or heart in a VFib, we don't convert that, we just leave it and patient is fine. And you can see one of our patient was actually very sick, who underwent ventricular device, you can see. So not somebody asked me, so your hospital is very nice, they're giving wine to this patient. I said, not wine, it's a hot close syrup with water. So it's like wine. So you can see here, this person, he was lying in some hospital in ICU for nearly 2 months. So he came to our hospital and he underwent ventriculosis device. We stabilized him, we improved his nutrition state. And you can see here the same console, you can see what we've shown there. This is he underwent subsequently underwent transplant. So we got within 1 month heart, so we were able to do transplant. So this boy, he was a DCM, dilated cardiomyopathy with 10% ejection fraction. So he came here and we registered him for transplant. So he was waiting in the ward for some evaluation, for pre-transplant evaluation. So we got a call that the patient is arrested in the ward. So our code blue team went and resuscitated him and brought him to ICU and started him on IABP. BP was 50, 60, and he started getting repeated VT and VFib. I think we shocked him nearly 50 times. So it was every 5 minutes he was getting VT. Then thought we may lose him, so we pushed him and put a biventricular support. Then VT stopped, and not worry also about the VT or VFib after that. So he was unconscious for nearly 1 week because of ischemic encephalopathy. And he regained consciousness. He started doing exercise. You can see he's doing a float cycle. So he's a young fellow, recovered very fast, then underwent transplant. So so I don't go in detail about this this device. So this is an implantable device. So Julius can show some patients of this. So it can be implanted. It's only a left ventricular device possible. Now totally implantable heart also available, but not you are not used to those things. So these are the old trials. This is a heart where it can be used even for the destination therapy. This is a device goes inside the heart. So this also comes with some complication like right heart failure, infection, GI bleed, hepatic valve insufficiency. So these things not like you put these devices, heart will work, so you should make it work and also balance the left and right heart properly, then only these devices work. So, and also the LVAD thrombosis is another major problem. So I don't want to go in detail about these studies. And next is heart transplant. So heart transplant, we started here 2015 December. I still remember this person was referred to me for heart attack or MI from one of the nearby nursing home. So the resident called me and said that I am sending one patient to 65 years. I have tried to do ECG. He accused us saying that you are trying to make money out of me. So this man who came here and got admitted and LV was totally gone. It was almost like 1 week old MI. So we did angiogram. It was left main and diffusely diseased arteries. So there was no chance of doing any intervention. So MD was very poor. So this man had then started having recurrent ventricular fibrillation and tachycardia. So for him also, I think we shocked more than 20-25 times. Then family requested, do not resist it, so you just leave him. I want to sit with him for some time. So allowed his son to sit with him. And he was conscious, he was getting VT. And we said, to shock or not? They said, do shock. Every time he said, don't shock, when he was all right, but when he was getting VT, he said, shock. So that went on for some time. Then he took back his DNR consent. And this man underwent transplant. Now 6 years, he's living healthy life. I done angiogram 2 months back, and biopsy is absolutely normal. The problem with transplant is availability of the heart. So in Karnataka, we get only 50-60 donors. In that, usually 1/3 is eligible for heart transplant. So thanks to neuro team, so they are the one gift us heart. So only 1/3 or 2/3 is eligible to donate heart because of the many reasons. So that is the reason, very difficult to do whatever the required transplant to all patients who are eligible. So you can see those who are survival, 10-year survival was around 50% in 1992. And I think we are reaching more than 65%. I think present is 75% at 10-year survival and 80% at 5-year survival. So this is a person who's not, it is not possible him to survive even one day. So he's getting 10-year survival. So advanced heart failure is represent a spectrum of illness. It's, keeping patients on inotropes is very difficult. They all get into complication or they die of VT or VFib. And those who are not on inotropes, those who are in rehospitalization or those who are on ACE inhibitor, ARBs, worsening renal function, repeated ICD shocks. These are the patients who are eligible. PAD is rapidly emerging, and the present generation VADs are much better. Probably, hopefully, one day it will replace transplant, because many patients will get benefited. But only thing is, it's very, very expensive. Probably not for Indian patients, or one day this cost of LVAD will come down like a pacemaker so that everybody can use it. Thank you.
Do we do questions now or after both talks?
You can complete, sir.
I think we can continue with the talk and then take questions at the end.
Can I share screen then? Could you enable that?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you for coming. Thank you, Nagmalesh, sir, for having a wonderful talk. And so we'll take the questions later. Now I'm going to introduce one more speaker, Dr. Julius Ponnan. Dr. Julius Ponnan is alumnus of Ramayan, MBBS 1981 batch. Sir is a senior consultant, cardiac surgery and heart transplant in Narayana Institute of Cardiac Sciences, Bhumsundra, Bangalore. He has done a lot of transplantations, heart and lung transplantations. His professional goals include heart and other organ transplantation while making cardiac surgery accessible to all in partnership with government and non-government agencies, and make it all viable financially in long term. Sir has done many transplantations, as I already told. His field of expertise is adult cardiac surgery, pediatric cardiac surgery, cardiac transplantation, heart valve tissue banking, cardiovascular and thoracic surgery. He is a member of a lot of professional bodies, and sir has done a lot of national and international publications. So over to our alumnus, Dr. Julius Poonam. Thank you, sir.
Can you hear me? We have to make these checks,
sir,
prior to online talks, I think. So good afternoon, everyone, and thank you very much for this opportunity. Especially thank the Alumni Association So Rada was the first medical college in this to do transport. We were the first to use an air ambulance to transport an organ. Nagamalesh had actually
there's some background noise. Can you hear some problem with your voice? I think there's some it's cracking. You're not able to hear full sentences.
Try to get a little closer. Is it any better now?
Yeah, it's better.
And come closer and talk.
Yeah, I am. I'm almost kissing the computer by now. So, did you hear anything at all?
I think we can start from the beginning.
Yeah. Okay, I was just saying that I'm very proud to be alumni of this great institution. So from the heart transplant perspective, Ramaya was the first medical college to do a heart transplant in the state. It is the first medical college it's the first private medical college in the country to do a heart transplant. Ramaya was the first to use an air ambulance to transport a donor heart. Nagamalesh had organized that. I was scared to get into these helicopters, so I stayed back in the theater and operated. I would like to refresh your memory that Ramaya was the first to do a kidney transplant in the state of Karnataka. So the solid organ transplant account was opened in Karnataka with Ramaya. That time I was an intern. I was involved in looking after that patient at some point of time. And these are things which have inspired us to take up transplant as a career in future. So it is customary to do a bit of introduction and other things. We have heard so far that cardiac transplantation is the most definitive treatment for end-stage heart disease. There are a lot of other things we can do, medical treatment and some, devices and all the other things. But clearly, heart transplant is the most definitive treatment for end-stage heart disease. The limitation being organ availability. We can't possibly do heart transplant for all those who need it because there are a limited number of organs that are available. And just to put things in perspective, advanced heart disease is the principal cause of death in nearly 40,000 patients in the US annually. And it is a major contributing factor in 250,000 others. We do not have any clear statistics to tell how much we will need in India. Going by the population, you can do the math. And the direct cost of heart failure is estimated to be $108 billion worldwide. A bit of history. There are a whole lot of people who contributed a great deal to cardiac transplantation. I don't know if you can see my cursor at all. Can you see my cursor on the screen? Okay, so there is Dr. Shambe and Lower, who actually developed all the techniques for the standard heart transplantation. And there was also Reeds and Professor Yacoub, who did the techniques for bicable transplant, and Dreyfus did the total transplant. So I've not had the pleasure of meeting the people in the top row, but Dreyfus and Professor Yacoub have visited us in the hospital. So I've had the pleasure of spending some time with them. Unfortunately, both of them are no longer doing transplants, and the technique of total heart transplant is not practiced much in the world now. Now, this is a very famous picture from the Life magazine. The first heart transplant really made big waves in the lay press. It was really life-changing, particularly for the surgeon. Maybe not so much for the patient, because he lived only 18 days after the surgery. But for that time, the whole important thing was he proved that heart transplant is possible. There were things which were not foreseen at that time, and because it was the first transplant, they did not really know a lot. But for the surgeon, it was really life-changing. Following the transplant, he had all these supercars in his garage, boats, yachts in Monte Carlo, and supermodel girlfriends around him all the time. Certainly, life was very different for cardiac surgeons who did transplant at that point of time than it is now. We are still waiting for all of that to happen, but unfortunately, it doesn't really happen. Now, in terms of patient selection, basically what we are looking at is there should be a proper indication. There should be absence of contraindications. So the contraindications can be from other organs in the body, like if your liver is failing or if you've got terminal malignancy, you're not going to be a transplant candidate. If you're expected to live a reasonably long life, other than the heart condition, then and you have an indication for transplant, they're the ones who become candidates for heart transplant. Now, I'm the reason I put up this indication, the exclusion criteria is because these are rapidly changing. What we thought is not transplantable even a few years ago have turned out and become indications for transplant, like amyloidosis, for example. We never wanted to transplant amyloid patients before, but now we take that as an indication for transplant. The age limit has changed, the body surface area has changed, we tend to accept more renal insufficiency. And the thing which is really revised downwards is the fixed pulmonary vascular resistance, because when the pulmonary vascular resistance is high, the hearts tend to not work when you put a transplanted heart. And it's a very precious resource which you do not want to waste. Therefore, and also because of the availability of LVADs, you don't want to put an organ into a person in whom it may not work. So you might want to put them on an LVAD for a while and then figure out if that's going to get better or not, and then do a transplant. Now, what is important in transplant is to start by assessing the donor heart very well. Famous transplant surgeon John Walwerk said, "You cannot make chicken out of a fried egg." So if you mess up the donor heart in terms of assessment, preservation, transport, or handling, then your transplant is not going to go very far. The organ might fail and the patient might die on you right away. So there are a lot of things which we look at in terms of assessing a donor, in terms of size match, age match, all of that. The higher the donor age, the worse the outcomes are, as in, when it goes above a certain age. And you need to assess the coronary arteries and all that. And without saying, it makes common sense that the donor heart should have good function. And more than anything else, it is the visual evaluation by an experienced transplant surgeon which is considered the most important part of a donor assessment. And these are standard contraindications, stands to common sense to a large extent. Now, serology positivity was considered bad, but now a lot of times we are accepting hearts which are positive in one way or the other, because if somebody has got a life expectancy of less than 1 month with heart failure, and you have potentially treatable conditions like HIV and HCV, it's a choice one has to make. Do you want to, get infected with HIV or HCV with a heart that is going to bring you the infection and take prophylactic or therapeutic measures for that? Or would you, not take that and die in a month from your heart disease? So these are gray areas. in some places where they accept these. We haven't started doing that yet in the country mostly. But, you know, HBsAg positive hearts can be used in HBsAg positive recipients and similarly for HCV. And if there is a lot of viral loads, probably not very smart to do that. And same thing goes with bacterial infection. We probably don't take somebody who's got multi-resistant organisms and all of that. And malignancies, other than brain tumors, are clearly a contraindication. And there are a lot of other cardiac contraindications as well. And as I said, the important thing is when you take a heart, you have to preserve it at a microvascular level, cellular level, and maintain the functional integrity of the heart during the entire process. Now we have stopped the blood supply to the heart, take it out and put it into ice and transport it for a few hours on the road or air or whatever, bring it back and then, you know, re-anastomose it into a recipient, and you expect it to work. And you expect it to work right away and take the load of the entire body. Now, isn't it asking for a bit too much for a heart which has been abused so much to come and start working right away? So these preservative solutions and the techniques which have been developed very carefully by the people whom I mentioned before have made that possible. So when some hearts fail to work, you shouldn't be surprised. You should be surprised why the majority of them work well. Just want to, you know, I just can't help it. I have to tell you something surgical because I'm a surgeon. Nagamalesh has given you all the medical gyan. So, you know, we are merely technicians in the hands of our physicians. So we just stitch the heart in and the rest of it is looked after by Nagamalesh and the medical team. So when you're doing the donor heart procurement, the most important thing is to assess the heart very well, to make sure that the heart is well. So we palpate the coronaries, we make sure that there are no congenital anomalies that are seen from the outside. And, you know, we make a good assessment of the heart and then tell the recipient team that they can start the operation on the recipient side. So it is usually a simultaneous harvest of all the organs. You know, the abdominal team will be doing the liver and kidneys and all of that. And after all this, the tissues are taken, cornea, etc. So for the heart as such, what we do is we would cross-clamp the aorta and give the preservative flush, which makes the heart stay for the next 3-4 hours without dying itself. And then slowly cut all the attachments, which includes the inferior vena cava, the superior vena cava, aorta, and pulmonary artery and pulmonary veins. So the veins are cut individually, the pulmonary arteries are cut individually when the lung is not being harvested. When the lung is harvested, then we usually have a little bit of a fight between the lung team and the heart team as to, you know, who takes more. So everybody wants more of the left atrium and the pulmonary artery. The lung team wants it, we also want it. So we generally come to a compromise on internationally accepted line of controls. Same thing happens about the IVC with the liver team sometimes. And at the same time, as we start the donor harvest, on the recipient side, somebody else would do the recipient surgery also. Once we say that we are cross-clamping, then they start with going on bypass and start removing the heart. So, earlier, we used to wait till the heart really came into the theater before we cut out the recipient heart. But now, to save time, we tend to start with removal even before they arrive. You know, a lot of places do that to save the cross-clamp time. So there are two basic techniques of anastomosing the donor heart to the recipient. One is called the biatrial technique, which is what most of us older people have learned. And subsequently came the bicaval technique, where the atria are completely removed and the anastomosis on the right side is done to the superior and inferior vena cava rather than to the right atrium. The upper diagram shows the way you remove the donor heart, leaving the right atrium and the left atrium behind. The lower diagram shows that the right atrium is removed and you have only the superior vena cava and the inferior vena cava and the left atrium. there is some amount of preparation that is required of the donor heart. We cut between the pulmonary veins to make them into one chamber of the LA, and also release a few structures from here and there to make it easier to do the stitching. So there are, again, as I mentioned, there are two ways of putting it together. The upper diagram shows the bicable technique, where the left, you can see and the left atrium is anastomosed to the left atrium, and the middle part is the interatrial septum. So that forms one wall of the left atrial anastomosis. And when you're doing the right side on the biatrial technique, there is a second suture line on the septum, and the right atrium is anastomosed separately. Whereas in the bicable technique, the inferior and superior vena cava are anastomosed individually. That is the main difference. The most people use bicable technique now. Even in Ramaya, we used biatrial in the first few cases, and then Ravi, who is the current surgeon, shifted to doing bicable technique. So we generally do the bicable technique, which has some advantages over the biatrial technique in terms of late development of tricuspid regurgitation and all that. So for the outflow anastomosis, you require to connect the aorta and the pulmonary artery. It's pretty much the same in both instances, but at the end of it, the bicable one looks like what is above. You have two anastomotic lines for the right atrium, and in the biatrial technique, you have one set of anastomosis for the right atrium when you see from the outside. So at the end of the operation, you have to remove the air from the heart very, very carefully, because if you don't remove the air, that goes into the right coronary artery, and then the right heart will not work. And that becomes a big problem, which sometimes requires mechanical support, etc. And a lot of times the heart doesn't work very well right away. So you may require some pacing because the sinus node may be dysfunctional. And you must remember that the heart is completely denervated, and many of the drugs work very differently, because some have a sympathetic or parasympathetic component to their action, which is not there in a transplanted heart. So we may have to look at the way each drug works in a very different manner. So you will require some amount of support usually. Sometimes you may require IABP or ECMO if there is graft dysfunction. There are a lot of problems that can possibly happen after a transplant. Hyperacute rejection is common for all solid organs. I haven't seen one, and I hope I never see one in my lifetime. It is very rare because we do cross match, and we look at the HLA antigens and antibodies and all of that. So generally these things don't happen. It happens in a setting of, accidental labio mismatch, or if there are pre-existing anti-HLA antibodies, or sometimes non-HLA antibodies also. But it's not something most surgeons today have seen, and hopefully nobody will see it. If that happens, the heart gets completely destroyed in front of your eyes, and there is no way that heart will recover. Early graft dysfunction is something which we see with reasonable frequency, and most of them recover if you were to put them on some mechanical support for a period of maybe a week or so, and then they gradually get better. And almost all the patients whom I have seen where the heart is not working at all at the end of the operation also tend to recover over a week's time. And there are a bunch of other complications which can possibly happen. With an operation of this magnitude, I'm sure you would expect a lot of complications that could possibly happen. A word about immunosuppression. We use what is called as induction therapy, so that we can delay use of some of the other drugs which can be nephrotoxic. And so you have one set of induction drugs, then you have maintenance, and then there is treatment of rejection. So as time passes, almost everybody gets some form of rejection, and chronic rejection and the vasculopathy in the coronary arteries is something which happens over a period of time for Nearly all. Sometimes they. It's very interesting. When someone lives 30 years, we don't know why he lived 30 years. When someone lives only 2 years, we still don't know why he lived only 2 years. So, you know, a lot depends on things which we do not really understand. So this is some pictures from one of our early transplants in Ramaya. The first one shows the recipient heart being removed, the donor heart being prepared in the middle one, and the implant happening in the third picture. So I'm saying this is one of the early transplants because I'm standing on the right side of the table, which I stopped doing for a long time. I usually stand on the left side of the table and help younger surgeons do the operation these days. And that's been the way for several years now. There are some devices which we use for medium to short term support. The go-to device for us is either ECMO or Centrimag, which Nagamalesh had shown earlier. And there are some other devices which might end up getting used in the future. One is the Abiomed impeller pump, which is done by cardiologists. The limiting factor is it costs about 25 lakhs for the disposables. And the last one at the bottom is called Syncardia. It is a total artificial heart where you excise the recipient's heart and put this device, and it is usually used as a bridge to transplant. Again, the limitation is cost. This one costs about 2 crores or so. I don't know, maybe someday we will get there. And these are other LVADs. The one at the bottom have all been discontinued from the country. Only the ones on the top row are available. That is HeartMate 2, HeartMate 3, and EVA Heart. EVA Heart has just been introduced. Nobody has done an implant of EVA Heart so far. From the middle low, the Ventresis device is what we were using about 10, 15 years ago. Now, that company wound up for business reasons, even though it was a fantastic pump. It is nice that many patients outlived the company with this device on. There are still some patients who are alive with this device and the company, I think, shut somewhere in 2010 or so. We transplanted our last patient who was on this device in 2018. He had the implant done in 2008. So 10 years he was on this device, and then we did the transplant. The lower level ones, the Javik Heart and Heartware, are no longer available in the country, and Heartware has been withdrawn from the market completely. So this is the HeartMate 2 device. You can see what it looks like on the upper left picture. You need to make a sort of a core at the apex of the left ventricle, and then you fit this device into that sleeve, and actually you tie it up with garbage bands, and you know cable ties which you use to tie garbage bags, that's what holds it together at the end of the day. So here is a patient who is on a temporary device doing some exercise, and these other two have had LVAD, durable LVADs, with which they go on home, and some of them are bridge to transplant, some of them are as destination therapy. Now here is a condition which not many people would have seen, even amongst cardiac surgeons. There is no heart or lungs in the chest. So maybe, pathologists and forensic medicine people get to see this sometimes, but then, that is at a different point of time. Here, we have removed the heart and both the lungs from the chest, and the patient is on cardiopulmonary bypass. So we bring in a heart-lung block. You can see the two lungs and the heart in the middle. There is some red part seen on the right lung. That is because of trauma, which you can remove it with staples. So here we are putting the heart-lung block into the chest. The arrow points towards the tracheal anastomosis. You can also see the aorta on top of that. So the rest of the procedure is pretty much like heart transplant. You will need to make the aorta, SVC, and IVC anastomosis. The pulmonary arteries are already connected because it is coming on block. Now you see a patient who was on ECMO, ventilator, and a tower of medications, who had the transplant, continues to be on ECMO, because the graft function was suboptimal and he's being ambulated on ECMO. And the last picture was taken yesterday. So this transplant was done about 3 weeks ago, and now he is sitting up and exercising himself. So today the transplant is very dramatic and life-changing for the patient, maybe not so much as it was for the surgeon. Thank you very much.
I think if any questions are there, any audience, please feel free to ask. Amulet sir is also there, and Dr. Julius. Please unmute. Those who are asking questions, please unmute and ask the questions.
One question.
Yes.
I just want to inquire about pediatric heart transplants are also.
Yes, we do pediatric heart transplants. So broadly, we have two types of pediatric heart transplants. One is the children who have got normal morphology with cardiomyopathy or some other problems which is myocardial in origin. Then you have the congenitally malformed hearts, which have like single ventricles and all the other ones which fail over a period of time. But you may have various other congenital anomalies that are present with that. And all of these we can handle. Remember, when we get a donor heart, they are of normal morphology. You do not get the same morphology as the child who is undergoing the transplant. So there are techniques described by which we can tailor the the heart which you receive to the child with abnormal morphology. So what we normally do is, with the imaging data that is available, I make what is called my architectural diagram and make a plan as to what to stitch where. So you will be able to manage most of these anomalies without much difficulty. Just that it requires some planning. We can't just go blindly and start with that. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you. But how common is it
when
we compare it to
others? We've done quite a few.
First pediatric heart transplant was 8 years old in Romania. We got this donor heart from Bangalore. That baby died of some meningioma or something.
It is a brain tumor.
After surgery.
I went to Bangalore to pick up that heart. Yeah.
Now sister has come. The same problem. She is also now 8 years. This boy is 14 years now. It's fine.
So we've done a child who was 4 years old from Assam. So that is one which we've done in NH. But those were all cardiomyopathy. But the exciting thing is to tailor a donor heart to the abnormal morphology. Like suppose there is a situs inversus, for example, it becomes quite challenging to put everything together. So even if there is a L malposition of the aorta and pulmonary artery, you might just find that the aorta and P are reversed in its orientation. You might have a left SVC or something like that. Those are things which we can plan out to make the anastomosis. Sometimes instead of anastomosing to the main pulmonary artery, you would want to anastomose the pulmonary artery to the left or right pulmonary artery where it aligns well. So the blood doesn't care which part of the pulmonary artery it reaches, as long as it reaches both lungs. So when there is situs inversus and all that, the one easy thing to keep in mind is try and bring everything to the midline. Then it makes it easier and we'll be able to deal with it a lot easier. So that we do that. We've done quite a few. We are a large pediatric hospital in NH. We've done a large number of, we do about 2,500 pediatric heart surgeries a year. So some of our own patients who had single ventricle repairs in the past and others have undergone transplant here.
Thank you.
Julius, one more question, both Dr. Mulji. Do you perceive at some point that we do not depend on donors and have a heart, easy to procure sort of a heart and a non-donor heart?
There are two, three things which we can consider, Ravi. One is xenotransplantation. You know, the famous saying from Norman Shumway is that xenotransplantation is the future of transplant, and it will always be the future, which means it's not going to happen. But that is not true today. There is a lot of progress that has happened in xenotransplantation, and you might find that, you know, sort of happening at least on an experimental level in our practice lifetime. The second thing is what is, you know, organs grown in the lab. So far, even sure, you know, sure. So even 5 kilometers from here, you can see cells being grown which work as a syncytium. But as an organ, we have not seen any being grown so far. The general thought is that the first organ that might get grown in a lab would be the liver, because, you know, what does biochemical work seems to be easier to reproduce than what does mechanical work. So yes, liver is possible to make, but at the moment it costs some $80 million to make a liver. So, you know, obviously that is not commercially viable, and that was just the proof of concept. But then, you know, over a period of time, I think that is going to come up as a commercially viable solution. And then obviously the next thing will be getting other animals, skeletal, fibrous skeleton and cellular, putting cells into it as a way of cellularizing those fibrous skeletons from your own tissue. So these are things which might take some more time, but certainly there are a lot of things which are coming around. And there is a lot of improvement in the LVAD and total artificial heart technology from what it was a while ago. If you look at the history of that, in the 60s, two projects were taken up by, was given out by the US government, the Congress. One was to put a man on the moon, and the other one was to make an artificial heart. And it was certainly thought that putting a man on the moon was easier than making an artificial heart. And putting a man on the moon happened much earlier than an artificial heart. So then somewhere along the line, they gave up on the idea of doing artificial heart and made LVADs. At that time, LVADs were very bulky and they were pulsatile and had valves, and they failed in 6 months to 18 months time. So today they have become much smaller and it works on a continuous flow technology, and they can last 10 years or longer. So this engineering is constantly being reformed and revised, and maybe it might substitute heart transplant at some stage with engineered devices. So there is mechanical ones and there are biological ones. So one of them might solve our problem.
Yes, Professor, we can use LVAD.
How long can you
use total artificial heart? Depending on, see, LVAD by definition supports only the left ventricle. So if your problem is biventricular, then you cannot use an LVAD. If the right ventricle fails, then the LVAD will not function. So then you need some form of a biventricular support. Today, the standard biventricular support is transplant or total artificial heart. Total artificial heart is a much bigger undertaking than LVAD, because total artificial heart requires you to excise the ventricles and put cuffs onto the atria and do that. And currently they cost some 2 crores or so. And it is used as a bridge to transplant. So for all these, cost will be a limitation.
For your survival, I think you asked.
Yeah, Dr.
If you ask, if we previous generation, first generation, year survival is just 20%. Now it's come to 79% event-free survival with the momentum-free trial. So that is a big development. So from 20% has gone up to 80%, almost 80% survival.
So before a transplant happens, how much, how long can you use the LVAD?
There isn't anything like that.
Longest LVAD here. Mm-hmm. No, that is, there are two types of LVAD. One is durable LVAD, that is implantable. That can go on, like they use for 10 years and then they transplant after 10 years.
Okay.
So this man would have died, he received his LVAD, lived for 10 years. Now he got his heart and he lived for another 20 years of his life.
Yeah.
So, but the temporary VAD, what I showed one patient,
yeah,
was wearing that, yeah, temporary VAD, that is eligible to do transplant within 1 month. That is, approval is there for 1 month. Here, for one patient, we did not get heart for some reason during that period. We put for 6 months. That is actually record now.
No.
In the country. So we have kept him for 6 months on LVAD. Then transplanted. Anyway, died because of stroke after that. But we kept him for 6 months.
So if you look at the outcomes, or in other words, if somebody were to ask me, would you choose an LVAD or a transplant if you want it for yourself? I would choose transplant, because the LVADs are great for the first couple of years. After that, slowly trouble will start. But transplant is a little more reliable on the longer term. See, all the comparison between LVAD and transplant are limited to 1 or 2 years. At 1 year, 2 years, they are equal or, you know, not very different. But when you look at 5 year or 10 year survival, transplant is far better than LVAD. I mean, the currently available ones. Tomorrow, I do not know what will be available. And a lot of problems are related to anticoagulation, bleeding, and LVAD itself causes some disturbance to the circulation because the body is built for pulsatile flow. We are altering it by doing only continuous flow. And that causes a lot of changes to the body, like angiodysplasias. You know, you may get spontaneous brain hemorrhages from that, GI hemorrhages. And also you may get pump thrombosis. So pump thrombosis or pump dysfunction is also possible with LVAD. Transplant, it's very rare for it to fail suddenly. You know, it can happen. I'm not saying it won't happen, but, you know, it is relatively, you know, less common for a transplant to have a sudden failure. And you can always have a retransplant. You can have retransplant multiple times.
Most important thing is they go back to work. Most satisfying.
Most satisfying.
Those who are laying at home with heart failure and getting admitted repeatedly, most of them, they have stopped working for 2-3 years before the transplant. They go back to work, so that's the most satisfying thing. If he leave for 10 years, he can take off his.
You saw the last slide I showed. He was nearly dying. He was on ECMO, he's in respiratory failure. And, you know, it's very dramatic once you do the operation and put in a pair of new lungs and heart.
Sir, one more question. Sir, I think lay persons are very much curious about this green corridor, which is happening. And how much time is from harvesting to transplantation, which is a good one?
4 hours, you say. Within 4 hours, we have to complete the transplant. But we'll try to do as early as possible. That's all. So sometimes from here also we take, but we stop taking green corridor which is nearby, like some Astor Hospital or some Spurs Hospital. We don't take. It just come like that. It may take another 5 minutes extra maximum. But if you're coming from NH, from NH to here, suppose if you mess up there in between, you may stand there for the next 2-3 hours. See, that time we take green corridor so that there should not be any problem. We got very hard from Mysore.
Yes.
So, green corridor.
Chennai and all, sometimes it's coming here.
Chennai only from the hospital to airport.
Yeah.
Airport.
Okay.
Once we have heart from Apollo Hospital to Ramaya, where we showed that helicopter. So, we found there's not much difference. You know, we have to pay 70,000 per one trip from there to here. Here, our old ambulance will bring.
So once we had transported an organ by commercial flight from
COPD patient for carcinoma, they also similar.
No, see, COPD patient lung is gone.
Okay.
You can't replace the heart. You have to replace heart and lung.
Heart and lung.
So we had once brought an organ for a child from Mangalore. I think that was a very well arranged green corridor. They picked us up from the tarmac. And I think by the time the people from the flight got into the got out of the airport terminal, we were in Ramaya. They had cleared the entire length of that elevated road from the airport till Hebbal. And we got there in really very quick time.
Just they will look at us, they'll get surprised the way we do it. Just see, I think everything, whatever we do is to save money first. Next, otherwise it will not happen.
Exactly.
So we get it in a commercial flight sometime. So they ask us to book two seats, not one seat. Keep that, they don't want to keep it down.
Yes, one for the heart.
So we have to keep it there and put a flight also for that.
Well, the time I brought from Mangalore, they kept it along with the coffee machines.
So we face a lot of problems. So basically we're trying to reduce cost to patients. We do all this. And when you come to airport, they'll ask us to open the box.
A lot of media is behind that, and it's just
we should open the box and get contaminated. So, to give letters saying that this heart won't open. And we have to come through security things, they won't allow. So, we have to come through other things, we have to do it. But somehow, many times we reach here in 2 hours, all this. Only thing is, when they harvest and bring it to flight, sometimes there'll be some 10 minutes. Difference, sometimes they wait, don't go away. You tell before that.
Yeah,
your own chartered flight is be good and because you're very expensive. Cost almost 5 to 6 lakhs in Karnataka.
Just for the transportation.
Transportation, just for transportation.
Surgical transportation.
Yes. If you
the rate, it will be very high.
So, we charge around
15.
So,
to add transport, 15 plus 5, approximately. Which is worth it
because it's
giving life.
Yeah,
definitely.
But if you look at patients who undergone, today 3 patients came, they are so healthy. So, one fellow completed his engineering and he's working. Other fellow got married, he got one kid now.
Oh,
after the transplant. Transplant, he married his girlfriend.
Yeah.
So she agreed, actually.
She saw the different heart and she must have.
It's a big question to ask. So now we have transplant. I think 5 days back, we have done transplant and that lady is doing well now. They are educated people, so it's your teacher, actually. So our doctor came and asked me today, is there any change in our behavior?
Yeah.
This is just a mechanical pump.
We had this patient whose wife left him when he was diagnosed with heart failure. So then he went on to have a transplant, then he got married again, and then he had made another completely different family.
More patient.
Yeah.
That's what I put to relaxation. Easier. He went through a lot of psychological problems. He's fine now. Just put on a little weight.
Sir, what is the success rate of the transplantation?
So, the transplant, 10% is the mortality during surgery. First 30 days. 30 days is a 10% mortality. So, 5 years survival is around 75%, 80%. 10 years around 70. To look at our Ramaya data, also same thing. They're not different from others. Initially, I thought they are much better than other places. Julius will keep telling me, you will catch up with the world. You just wait. We did it because what happens? Initially, you'll be very carefully doing low risk. Once you are confident, you start taking high risk. So you'll have more mortality. You put bad, mortality is high. Take patients with ECMO mortality is high. So in that way, we'll catch up with the statistics. So eventually. Some of it's the same, mortality is same.
This is the cost for a heart transplant?
Around 10 to 15 lakhs.
So one last question from myself. So the reason we started actually thinking about this cardiac transplant, the talk is mainly because what I came to know is Ramaya Hospital is doing very well and it's top in having a cardiac transplantation. Just wanted to know where in India or overall other world, how much is our transplantation and where we are standing?
If you look at the world, US is doing yes. They're doing 2,000 plus, sir, now?
Sorry,
US?
Yeah.
US,
no,
plus.
Overall, I think there's about 4,000 hearts a year.
So overall is around 4,000.
Okay. Yes, worldwide. Of which about half is North America.
In Karnataka and Ramaya.
Yeah, Karnataka together, we and NH doing around 20 transplants pre-COVID. So they do around 10 and we do 10, sometimes 8, 10, or 8, 10, something like that. So around approximately around 20 transplants. I think that is highest in Karnataka. One institute, one team is doing transplant, yes, 20 cases per year.
And soon we will be doing lungs and heart lungs also in Ramaya. You know, beyond the process.
We already recruited some patient. One patient died because of the COVID, we did not get heart. So now, because of COVID, last 1.5 years, almost 1 year, 8 months, we significantly reduced because no donor. So we have done this year, 5 transplants so far. Even peak, when there was a peak, we have done 1 transplant. When there was a peak COVID, there was so much stress out actually. And you know, there was so much stress out because one is protecting patients, another is protecting ourselves. Both are difficult. So what about, so if one of the members is positive, gone, your transplant is over. One of the members is positive, what about us? We are also there.
At risk.
A lot of stress actually. And for our luck, everything was ready, transplant was ready, we are in the donor side. We got a call saying that the recipient brother became positive. And when we were there only, we got a call saying that this lady was going to hospital to see his wife, her husband. And met with accident. Husband is in COVID hospital. So both COVID positive families. Otherwise, you would have died. This boy is engineering for the second year now.
Remember, I was saying that the indication for the age limit for transplant has been gradually going up. One of the reasons why that happened is because the first set of heart transplant surgeons started getting older, and then they started thinking, what operate somebody my age? So when we look at the transplant surgeons, most of us are a little on the older side. And COVID really got us all frightened to get into that space.
Significantly went down, the transplant. I think for them also, the less, if neurosurgery is busy, we become busy.
Trauma becomes less, and injuries and trauma becomes less because of COVID.
Yeah. So we want to become busy, they should become busy.
Yeah, if there's no traffic, there's no accident.
Yeah. So, chance of rejection is very less because we are doing a cross match before transplant. If you look at our data, is around 10% of the patient or 30% of the patients can have some sort of rejection, the grade 1 or grade 2, not grade 3. Grade 3 is very, very less. Probably out of 36 patients, only one patient had grade 3, or two patients had grade 3 rejection. Otherwise, grade 1 is very common, that we don't treat that grade 1, we just leave that. Grade 2 is around 10%. And we have one patient and had a grade 2 and we admitted for leave biopsy now. We treated her, sent home and we are doing leave biopsy.
there any questions from the others, from the online
audience? Any questions? I think.
So it's very nice. Thank you so much from both of you. I think officially you give orders. So I think Dr. Julius and Dr. Nandesh, thank you so much for that talk. It was very nice and a lot of knowledge that we got. I think one happy feeling is, as you had told, that two main things they wanted to do in the world in the 60s was to go to the moon and then a heart transplant. Moon, they have not gone after that. And heart transplant has grown. So that's a good trend. And so I think I congratulate both of you for the excellent work that is going on. And I think very soon, I think we should put Rame up in the maps, probably the largest number in India, and then slowly as high as we can go. Thank you so much. I would ask our secretary to also give a few words, a vote of thanks. And thank you so much.
Thank you very much, sir. It will token of appreciation. I think virtually we'll give it to Julius, sir, and Derek.
We'll send it to you.
We'll send it to you, sir.
I think we'll keep a space for Julius.
Come on, come on.
Photoshop on this. You can get many photos.
I can put the mask.
Vote of thanks from Arun.
Okay, thank you. We now conclude the second talk by our alumni, organized by Ramya Medical College Association. And the topic was very, very interesting, heart failure and heart transplant, the need of power, especially in terms of creating awareness and encouraging solid organ transplants. And it also gives us immense pride to know that Ramya Medical College, one of the pioneers among the medical colleges to have a transplant program, and especially related to heart transplant, we are one of the leading colleges, medical colleges, to perform highest number of transplants in this part of the country. It inspires a lot of our own alumni to take up transplant programs, and as Dr. Ravi Gopal Verma said, put Ramya Medical College on a larger podium in terms of the transplant program, not only in the country, but across the world as well. To our speakers today, Dr. Nagmalesh, Professor and Senior Consultant, Department of Cardiology at Ramya Medical College, and Dr. Julius Kunan, Senior Consultant, Cardiothoracic Surgery, and also a proud alumni of Ramya Medical College. We thank you very much for being part of this talk and sharing a lot of interesting insights in terms of the transplant program, and also telling us what is the way forward. Thank you so much, Dr. Nagmalesh and Dr. Julius Kunan, for sparing your time and giving us a talk on a very interesting topic. I also thank Dr. Shalini Nui, Vice Principal, Ramya Medical College, for being with us all through the series of today's talk, and encouraging our association. I thank President, Secretary, and all the alumni for participating in this talk, as well as all the participants offline and online who've been there part of this today's program. Going forward, from our association, we'll be conducting a lot of these programs. Not only talk, but also we would, going forward, we'll be organizing workshop seminars and contributing our association to the alma mater as well. Once again, thank you. Thank you very much.